Let's talk now a bit more about how computation works under the hood and what kind of computation operations we can do. So, first, Spark uses lazy execution. That means you only apply operations when the results are indeed needed. And only actions trigger this kind of execution, as only actions require certain results. A drawback of this approach is that you may have intermediate computation that can, like intermediate RDDs, that need to be recomputed multiple times for different outputs. For this reason, you can indeed persist the RDDs in memory or disk for later use. So this caching helps you to do this operation only once. Okay, many of the operations apply user-defined functions, or as we have seen, lambda, which are anonymous functions. We know already that code and closure of the code are serialized on the driver and sent to the executors. However, if you use class instances or functions, data, methods, the object, which is the class object, is needs to be serialized, which may include additional data and may lead to a large volumes of data that you don't expect. Okay, now we do our computation on these RDD partitions in parallel, and we try to reuse our local partitions as much as possible, moving the code to our data instead of moving the data to our code. So we have three basic type of operations on RDDs. Actions, which is said, they actually trigger this lazy execution, right, and generate a result. But where is the result being stored? Well, all these results are actually managed and delivered to the driver program, which is ultimately in charge for those results. Then we have transformations, well, which means you create a new RDD by applying some operations on an existing RDD that is also local. That's pretty good. And lastly, we have shuffle operations, which redistribute our data across the executors. So here's an example now, a session using PySpark. You can specify when you run PySpark, actually the Python version, like this, in your shell. So here we run this Python 3. So here is a very simple, well, what we call data intensive, not really data intensive, though, Python program for the simulation. Let's parallelize and some data. So what we want to generate is data 1 to 1, was it 10 million. So we have here 10 million values, so number 1 to up to 10 million, stored in an RDD called nums. Now we filter out odd values. So we only keep odd values here and store it in R1. And now we want to apply an operation to each of these values. Here we apply a function. So we take the value x that is in this list, we print x, but we also print the cube of x as well. So we generate from one data value indeed a new tuple that has two values inside. Now finally we have to up to this point there has been no data, there has been no execution done at all. Only now after I ha run an action, some computation will take place in parallel and a result will be generated. So a collect, the collect function is actually there, or the operation, to retrieve the data from all the partitions and return it as one data set. So by result.collect, I get this data set into my driver and I can print the values. So of course, I will get now a list of tuples. I get 1, 1, 3, 27, so the cube of the number for all the odd numbers as expected. So if I want now, I could also cache the results, but I probably should do it before line 13, because at this point my action has been done. And as we said, the drawback is that intermediate RDDs may be recomputed multiple times and there shall not be any data stored in memory, except if you talked about caching. So another example is computing Pi, which is now a more sophisticated program. So how can you compute pi and in an approximative way? You can think of it by throwing darts on the uni circle. You throw a set of darts and you figure out if a dart lands inside the circle or if it just lands inside a cube of length 1 outside of the circle. So this equation here, x times x plus y plus y times y, is pretty much the position, is taking the position of the dart. So we generate for a dart two positions, x and y. And this equation here is checking if the value is inside this circle or if not. If it is inside the circle, we return 1, otherwise 0. So now how can we throw many darts? Well, we have to parallelize this. So we create here a number of darts from 0 to num samples. Could be 100,000 or 1 million, however many you like. And then we apply this function sample. Okay, so we have defined a function sample here. And we apply a reduction operator counting how many instances there have been inside the uni circle. So this is our Python code. You can do this again in Java, which is a bit more writing, but therefore you have an advantage that the compiler does some error checking for you, as it is a strongly typed language in contrast to Python. Okay, so the output, by the way, of this algorithm is you have to multiply the number of counts, how many hits you have, with 4 and divide it by the total number of samples, and that gives you a good estimate of pi. So there are a lot of transformations that you can perform to create a new RDD. Remember that a transformation returns a lazy reference to a new data set and does not apply this function yet. So RDDs support all those operations that I list here. An interesting one is, for instance, the pipe operation. So you pipe the data of a partition through an external program that you may have. Therewith, you can basically connect arbitrary programs with a Spark program. We already seen map and filter operations, but there are many more. You can have a look at them if you are interested. So if you have a key value RDD, that means we have key value tuples stored and we can actually group, we can group by a key. That means it combines the values of the identical key in list. So you have basically a list of lists in which the first list is the set of groups and the second list is the entries for each group that are inside this particular set. We can reduce apply a reduction operation by each key. Yeah, you can sort, you can actually join. So lastly, we have actions that perform input output or return data to the driver. So all these actions, they trigger now our computation and they are always performed by the driver and alone by the driver and instruct and communicate obviously between the driver and the executors and perform the operations. So you can reduce data by aggregating the elements, applying a function to get a new value. The function should be commutative and associative, otherwise a different processing order will give you a wrong output. You can count the number of RDD elements, you can collect, which was returning the complete data set to the driver, so from all the partitions, and there are various more that you can have a look at. Let's talk briefly about shuffle. So the concept of shuffle is that you repartition, want to repartition the RDDs across the executors. This obviously requires network communication, so that means all the executors communicate with each other, which is very costly. You can typically set a number of partitions that you like. Some operations trigger this implicitly, but you can also enforce this explicitly using one of these operations listed here. For example, saying repartition into num partitions would change the current ID, whatever number of partitions it had, into a new number that you have specified here. Okay, so therewith you can parallelize further a large data set or reduce the number of executors that you want to operate on the data by specifying a lower number. The coalesce function is only able to reduce the number of partitions, but this is more efficient than repartitioning completely. So let me talk a bit about mistakes that happen when you use Spark for computation. So as we have a distributed memory system, we cannot use local variables in this system. So here, for example, we want to apply the for each operation on an RDD. So this for each operation, which you find here as an action, runs the function on each element of the data set. Sometimes that's really useful, but you have to be careful. So here we defined a counter value, and now we run this for each on our partition RDD, and we want to increment counter by this value. And then in the driver, we say print the value. Now pause the video and think about the distributed system. Think about a couple of partitions and the values and why this may produce a mistake. And I will now reveal and conclude why this is a problem. So assume you have partitioned your data into two partitions. Now, the counter value that is given here is part of our closure. So this variable together with this current value is transmitted to all the two executors that we have in our example. When we run this for each now on our data, so each of the two executors would run the code starting from value 0 and incrementing the current value that is stored in this RDD partition to the counter. So basically you do a local addition of the counter now, and then finally in the driver you would run this code to print the counter value. Well, this will print the value of our driver. So that is not what we intended to do. Also, when you are on an executor, you should not perform standard input-output, except for debugging. For example, I can do again a for each, and I say print line on it. Well, this output is never transmitted to the executor. Spark will store the logs individually, but you will have trouble debugging this approach. So try not to use for each at all, in fact. Good, lastly, object serialization might be slow. So in this case, I run rdd.map on a function of the class. So self.func is this function here. So what Spark needs to do to determine the closure, it finds out, okay, I need this class, my class, with all the members, the functions and the data, and you may have a huge amount of data stored in this class, which needs then to be serialized as well, of course, slowing down your code.